October 31st, 1996, interview with survivor Ilse Kuttner, K-U-T-T-N-E-R, maiden name Braun, B-R-A-U-N. My name is Ben Nachman, N-A-C-H-M-A-N. Interview conducted in Omaha, Nebraska, United States of America, in English. Can you give me your name, please?
Ilse Ruth Kuttner.
And how do you spell your last name?
K-U-T-T-N-E-R.
Ilse, where were you born?
In Berlin, Charlottenburg.
In Germany?
Yes, in Germany.
When were you
born? Alas. I was born 20th of February in 1921.
And how old are you today?
I admit it, I'm 75, going on 76.
Can you tell me something about growing up in Germany as a young child, your family, your
yes.
religious practices?
Yes,
and so
definitely.
On?
I grew up with my parents in Berlin in a nice neighborhood. My father was a representative of paper manufacturers and sold to wholesalers in Berlin who made products, paper products, from the raw paper. And he had the same manufacturers and clients throughout the time that he could hold his job for decades. And none of them was Jewish, not that I remember. And he was very busy all day long. He went to renew contracts or make new ones, draw up new ones, and came home to write it up from his scrap paper, and was very busy after supper to write out his contracts. But whenever I wanted to know anything or say or do anything with him, he always stopped right then and there or finished the sentence and sat in his comfortable leather chair in the smoking room, and I sat on the arm of the chair and I shot the questions at him. And he was not a proud man. When he didn't know the answer to a question, he would say, "I don't know, let's look it up," or "I'll look it up when I go in town and stop at the library." So we had a very good relationship, my dad and I.
Did you have any brothers or sisters?
Yes, I had a brother who was 10 years older, Siegbert. He was a workhorse. He worked very hard. He lived at home. He was 10 years old, I think I said that. And he was a music nut. He loved music in order to see opera, etc. Of course, I'm talking about classical music. He would be on stage as an extra, and then he could see opera and listen for free. And he befriended, he adored one famous opera singer, soprano, and he would polish her shoes or anything to be near her. And then he'd come home and tell fantastic stories. Whenever my mom said, "Okay, I call," then he got angry. He said, "You're all idiots, it's true." And we knew it wasn't, you know. But he was so crazy with music. We had a piano. Almost every German household had one, whether they played or not. And he had taught himself to play, and by ear. And he would sit down often in leisure time to play an aria and sing badly, but in tune, you know. And whatever he had heard in that opera, he could play right by ear. He was that gifted. But never anything was done with it.
Was your mother working outside the home?
No, not at all. She was a typical German housewife, homemaker. She baked and cooked a blue streak, and very well, I must say. And but never read, or cleaned the house all day long, again the railing from top floor to down, you know, over and over. She dusted and everything, but I never saw her read a book or a magazine. She was just a housewife, but to perfection, or trying to.
How about, did you have a large family living in your area, relatives?
Yes, not large. We didn't have such a large family, but a sister of my mother lived on the other end of the same block, and they were constantly together. They went shopping and browsing and cajoling around, I don't know, you know, almost daily together. And they had their fights, they would hang up on each other, and a few minutes or half an hour later, they call each other again and say, well, what's going on, jerk, or something, you know, and just kind of start up again because they were inseparable.
Did you have cousins living near you?
Yes, not near me, but that one cousin, Herbert, but I go back to that again. I want to come back to my birth, to square one. When I was born, I had a whole head full of black curls, and the nurses were crazy about that. Usually mothers at that time stayed a week in the hospital at least. And so they put red ribbon in my hair and showed me off, walked down the halls with me. And my grandmother, whom I didn't know, she died a year after I was born. But my mother told that story always. My grandmother, when she came visiting daily, she came and took that ribbon out and she said, you're damaging her brain. That's my excuse, what's yours? And to come back to my dad, the religious wise, not just my dad, our family through my dad, whose father, male generation backward, were almost all cantors, but he was a businessman. Anyway, but he had the voice and, you know, and the knowledge, Hebrew knowledge. So Friday night and Saturday on Yomim Tovim, everything stopped. My mother, of course, prepared delicious meals. As long as there was money still, he didn't lose his job yet. Or jobs. And after the meal, first the meal itself, of course, he would, we said Mautzi, and he made the Kiddush. And after the meal, we said Taberkat Hamazon, the grace. And then we got dressed in the last finery. We probably ate in our slips and gowns. And then you got up dressed nicely. And my father put polished, brushed his high silk hat, put it on, and had two velvet cases that he put in his tallit, and also his siddur or machzor, depending whether it was Shabbat or high holiday, and put it in a velvet case and a burgundy for Shabbos and a blue one for the Yomim Tovim. And it was embroidered with barachot, you know, in gold letters. And we would walk to shul, to temple. And when I say temple, the only thing that was different from Orthodoxy was that they had a mixed choir and organ played on Shabbat too. And that was the only freedom, liberty they took. But for the rest, it was as Orthodox as the next shul, because the women sat behind the trellis. You couldn't see them, or they couldn't hardly see down, and men downstairs. And
do you recall the name of that synagogue?
Frieden's Temple. Yeah, it was very near, as a walking distance. We didn't ride on Shabbos. We had no car, of course. That was before private people had a car.
Do you remember the rabbi at the synagogue?
Yes. The main rabbi, the young up-and-coming one, was Joachim Prinz, P-R-I-N-Z. He was my teacher later, too. And even later when it started, I was 12 years old when Hitler came into power. So I hadn't too many good years in Germany. But later on, kids would throw rocks at my dad, having the high hat and the package under his arm. By the way, the tallis was for the whole body. Only on Shabbat they had it narrowly folded. And on Yomim Tovim, he would cover the whole body. And Yom Kippur, he had the kittel on, a whole white gown, and then the tallis completely over him. And now come back to that. When kids threw rocks, it didn't deter him. He still wore the hi-hat, and we still marched to the synagogue. It was never a question like here. They asked the kids, you want to go to temple or synagogue? There was no question. We went, that was it. And Saturday the same way. And of course, you mean to Wim. And the thing that bothers me so, maybe I shouldn't say it, but I was very fond of the saying, "Bechol hamakom asher askir et shemi, avo elecha uverachticha." In every place that I hear my name remembered, I will come and bless you. And that was always my main slogan in my mind, you know, beside what we talked about, the you know, 36 Lamed Vovniks beside that. That was my slogan, like. But recently it bothered me so after we, with Rabbi Steele, we had that portion of the Torah in Simcha B'Shabbat in our study of the parsha of the day, of the week. And suddenly it hit me and I thought, I always liked that so well. It means you don't need a synagogue. Wherever you are and you call on the Lord, that's where the holy place is, like Jacob when he called it Bethel, you know, the place where he had the dream. He had it right in the desert. He didn't need a synagogue. That was a place where God came and blessed him. And I thought, this man that I just described to you, my dad, was so pious, not a phoniness or a habit, a dry habit. He really knew what he was reading and etc. And where was God when they called on him in Auschwitz? That really bothers me a lot.
When did you first start noticing changes taking place in Germany?
Almost immediately when Hitler came to power. However, things increased in terror and horror very slowly. Every day there was a stand with newspaper and it was wired that you couldn't very tightly, a wire with small mesh, that you couldn't destroy the paper. It was the Völkische Beobachter, the Nazi paper, the main paper. And it said always, among other things, the horror, how the Jews raped every Goyische neighbor, and every Schickse has been raped by a Jew, and there's in pictures, and not of the rape, but of the people with the long beard and the head, and sinister looking, and so on. And there was every time also attached a poster, the order of the day, you couldn't do this, you couldn't do that, and so on. But the worst that remains with me to this day is really the constant bellowing of Hitler, like Castro, if you ever heard him, he endlessly yells and screams. We don't hear it much anymore, but in the beginning when you heard him, this on every lamppost, on every telephone pole, was a loudspeaker. In Berlin, there were lots of lampposts telephone poles. It was a lot. So you couldn't escape the screaming of Hitler and the interruption, Sieg Heil, Sieg Heil. And if you lived near a place where there were mass marches and mass conveniences, they were convening together, torch marches at nights, and with that singing and yelling and all the time. I mean, you couldn't escape it. Even your house, it wasn't completely quiet. And that haunts me to this day. Whenever I hear, I think I told you, when I mowed the lawn on Sundays or something, on weekends everybody here listens to the ball games, of course, big deal. And they mow too. The men have their day off, so they mow and go outside. And over the moor, they want to hear the game going on, the progress of the game. And whenever that's on, it's so much noise and hollering and all that. It just made me sick. I didn't go out on weekends at all. I always would remind me of Germany as I grew up. That's one part of my Jewish education. I don't know where we will end, maybe in the middle of my story. We had in our high school where I went to gymnasium. That's not a gymnasium, a sports thing. It's a classical branch of high school. You either go to lyceum or gymnasium. I wanted to become a pediatrician, so I went to gymnasium, where you have French, Latin, Greek, etc., no English. In the other one, you have English, you have typing, shorthand, and cooking, and home economics. But two different schools. I went to the other. And we had a roster in school, was everywhere published, what lessons do we have this day. And twice a week there was a lesson called religion. And for the, that was divided in empty classrooms. One group had a Protestant denomination, one Catholic, and Jewish, not together. And we had a nice older woman teacher, but you really didn't learn much, just the basics like they do here in the very beginning. You had the very beginning, Bereshit, and so on, and a little bit, you know, and not very much, and mostly in German, and a little bit history, modern Jewish history, a bit this, bit that. What can you do in an hour? And I heard from a friend of mine that there was, that there were rabbinical students and also rabbis emeritus, rabboni, and that they gave Jewish instruction far away, about an hour and a half from where I lived. And I wanted to go there. I wanted to know more about Judaism. And I convinced a few friends to go with me. I didn't want to go alone that far, because my mom said she wouldn't give me the dime for the streetcar, the nickel. First of all, later we didn't have, but even when we had it, she thought it's just a fad, you'll get tired of it and you won't go. But I did go, and I went for 4 years or so. And I learned an awful lot. Hebrew, Tanakh Hebrew, not modern Israel, that wasn't even thought of then, it was Palestine. Jewish history, the biblical and the modern. The time we lived and even a little before, like Moses Mendelssohn and philosopher and Graetz, Heinrich, I think it's Heinrich Graetz, other philosopher. Buber, whom I met in person in Frankfurt later. And so I really enjoyed it because it was, I learned so much. And we had teachers, when you were interested, they fed you, even after school, they told you what books to read. And so every teacher likes a pupil that's interested and works and doesn't fool around.
During this period, was it difficult for you as far as how you were treated when you went to this religious school?
Not at first, no. As I was still in my younger years, I started maybe when I was 12 or something. Not too much, but then later, I look kind of Jewish, or what, they would throw stones or say dirty things, and you know, Judenschwein, and whatever. But it didn't bother me until I couldn't go anyway anymore. In the schools, there was segregation early. First we had to sit in separate rows of desks. We had desks in rows, lengthwise to the teacher, from back to the teacher. And the Jews sat on one side and the Goyim on the other. And this school had a lot of Jewish pupils, like Central High, I guess, you know, had a lot of Jewish pupils. So it looked more like the non-Jewish kids were in the ghetto than we. But then the difficulty in school was the dumbest kids were the biggest and earliest Nazis. And they, before we even came there, right, dirty things, and like Judenraus, Judenschwein, and all kinds of things that they had heard and learned on the street, you know, they'd write on the blackboard. And when the teacher came, she she or he couldn't say much. They just wiped it off. And some of them were Nazis too, but you didn't know at first. And then came the time we couldn't go to school at all anymore. As I say, gradually everything got worse. And we had to go leave school, that's all. And the teachers too, Jewish teachers, had to leave school. So Jews aren't that lazy or that unimaginative. They opened their own schools, hired their own teachers, bought textbooks, and the kids would come. However, public school was free. Jewish schools, of course, had to pay their teachers, pay the books, buy the buildings or rent it, whatever. So it was expensive, Jewish school. It wasn't the Jewish school with Judaism. It was regular school, only Jewish pupils and only Jewish teachers.
By this time, had the economic condition of your father, your family started to deteriorate?
Yes. It all went gradually, but worse and worse every day. Every day. And so I was only 1 year in the school, Jewish school. My father lost so many, almost all, you know, eventually, and we couldn't pay for that. So, I want to say one thing that went parallel with that. We were in scouts early on, boys and boy scouts and girl scouts, but then we couldn't be there either, mixed with other people. So they threw us out there, not the scouts, but the government. You couldn't be anywhere mixed with anybody. And so what, of course, the Jews come up with new ideas. They opened their own Zionist youth groups, which had all the activities of scouts, including Hebrew speaking. There were Hebrew lessons, shiur, shiurim. And every weekend we went on a trip, knapsack, sleep in tents or in a barn, whatever. So we stole our fun from the oppressors. And we really had good times on those weekends and so. And I was very young when I joined it, but my mother let me. I had a cousin who was one of the leaders in the youth group. And she convinced my mother she'd keep an eye on me. I was very young for that. There was a, like Cub Scouts, there's an age line, and so I was below it, but she convinced the group and my mother that I'd be all right. The only thing I was bad in that time, I was so little and runty, you wouldn't believe that now anymore, that I got easily tired and I was very susceptible to colds and stuff. But it was the grandest time that they provided us. We had all kinds of leaders who were the pioneers that went to Israel when it was Palestine time. They, when the English man did, they were the ones who made the Galil what it is today. It was nothing, it was swamp by Lake Hula, and it was the Galil was all swamp around, and they made down there, if you ever were there and saw, looked down on the lake, on Yam Kinneret, you saw the Ganya Aleph and Beit, the different kibbutzim. That was all the work of leaders of mine who worked with a gun on their shoulders, a plow and a horse, and from Golan Heights, from Ramat HaGolan, the Syrians would shoot. And some of them died, some didn't. They shot back, but there was a wall they could duck behind. So I was so glad in the Six-Day War that they could capture that wall. And I don't want to give it back.
Let me ask you, did you remain in Berlin all this time?
Yes. But at a certain point, that was a turning point when I couldn't go any longer to that school because we didn't have any money, not only not for school, even rent and food, everything dwindled down. A friend, I wanted from little on to be a pediatrician, always. That's why I took the classical line of education. And somebody, a friend of ours, came with a Jewish newspaper and showed my parents an ad, and me, where in Frankfurt am Main, there was a doctor of radiology who looked for students. And she said, why doesn't, a little ad. And the friend said, why doesn't Ilse apply? Okay, she won't be a pediatrician, but on the other hand, it's in medical field. She'll be in a hospital, so it isn't complete loss. It's not a complete loss. And I really was set against it. I want that or nothing. I'm always black or white. I don't know gray, with friendships or anything. I just wanted all or nothing. And I didn't want to. But my parents said, we can't pay school. What would you do here? There's nothing for you to do here. And so I finally agreed. And I wrote a resume, very childlike. I was 16 at that time. And I wrote, I like flowers, I like, you know, not clay marbles, but something like that, you know, very naive. And so this doctor, David, as his name was, the last name was David, he responded and through secretary, and he said, you're too young, to my parents, she's too young, but 16 is a, is 18, I think, is the age that they accepted. Did he? And so he said, but nowadays things are so difficult, we have to try everything to help our Jewish youth. Why doesn't she come here to Frankfurt on a trial training session? And
do you recall
6 months.
Year that was? What year?
Yeah, 36, end of 36. And that reminds me again, I have to jump again. I'm sorry if I confuse you. But when I said we had such fun and such great time with the Zionist youth group, that's the last trip we were allowed to make and could make and did make. I had skis, I rode skis, and we lived at the edge of Berlin. We are right in the wild woods, and I did cross-country skiing with great delight. And anyway, we made a ski trip. We went to Munich, Augsburg, and then up into the mountains in a tiny village called Rietzlan. I saw it one time, they had Winter Olympics there. And while I was in America, I saw it on TV. I thought, I know that, I skied there. And it was such an experience that I'll never forget.
Did you end up going to Frankfurt then at this time?
Yes, at April, I think it was April 36, but this was the winter, December, January, snow time, ski time. And so that is what the Jewish youth group, the Zionist youth group, did for us. Things that we would never, if I'd sat home and not join it, we would never experience that.
Can you tell me a little bit about your going to Frankfurt?
Yes. I tried, there too we stole in the hospital where I had training. I mixed up. David was a clinic, an x-ray clinic. No doctor had his own x-ray equipment at that time. There were special clinics, and it was a fairly big one with a lot of employees. And we took x-rays for the doctors. And then I tell you in a minute.
To interview with Ilse Kuttner. Ilse, you were telling me about you were working in this x-ray schooling in Frankfurt. Can you continue that, please, for me?
Yes. I was, of course, the youngest, and you were always on the bottom of the line of the workers. And little bit by bit, I learned more, and we did everything. We radiation already at that time for cancer patients. I learned many things, even other radiation, heat radiation, all kinds of tests we took, EKGs, head pictures, sinus, pyology, that is when you take a pyelograph, you take the kidneys or the bladder with a contrast. You spray in a contrast and then take a picture and see if the guy or the girl has stones, kidney stones, etc. So I learned all that, but you start with just developing pictures and dry them, wash them and dry, you know, rinse them and dry them. That's where you start, in the dark room.
Was this with a large class that you were with?
No. I was the only student, new one. They had several already who finished training and stayed on, and a boss, of course. But that was a wonderful thing. I worked later elsewhere, and so here, all the people that were above me, there was no resentment, no politics. You know, you, this, why, you know, we were friends. All of us were probably also through the pressure from the Nazis. We were very closely knit. And also there we stole joy and fun. Every weekend we'd buy deli and get together and have a ball, more or less, you know.
How long a period of time was this course supposed to be?
It was supposed to be 2 years, but didn't last. Because this Professor David was supposed to go to convention in Chicago. This was before we were in war with America. And somehow they made difficulty with the visa and the passport. He had the shots and everything. They wouldn't let him go. They made difficulties, the Nazis. He couldn't get a passport. And I don't know whether they threatened him or whatever happened. Weekends, on Saturdays and Sundays, we took turns. One had to be always there because you have emergency pictures here, like in the hospital. There in the hospital, they had no X-ray equipment either, not in every hospital. And so one of us had to be on duty. I was on Sunday duty the one time, and I get about my business. Professor David had his home, apartment, and part of the, that big clinic, you know, had all X-ray rooms, dressing rooms, etc. And usually after a while, he would have breakfast and come out. And he didn't come. I didn't hear any noise. So after a while, I went to the bedroom door, which was closed, and I knocked. There was no answer because he wasn't anywhere. And I knocked again, louder and louder, and nothing. So I called. He had a girlfriend, a live-in, older, really a white-haired old woman, but a very nice nurse, former nurse. And she was his girlfriend. And I called her. We had her number. And I said, I can't get any response from his bedroom. I don't know. He hasn't shown up or anything. So she says, just knock and go in and see and let me know. I went in, he was lying in bed and like lifeless, you know, and very red, hot looking. And I went back to the phone, I said, he must have a fever, he looks so hot and red. She said, well, open the window and I come over as fast as I can. And she did, and we went in, and he had taken either sleeping pills or injection or something to kill himself, tried suicide. Well, he got fast the ambulance and everything. He didn't die. But his family, who were in Holland already, had him, took him there, that he wouldn't be in Germany anymore. And that was still before any Polish war with Poland or anything. So it was easy to take people out at that time. And I said nowhere. I didn't belong in Frankfurt. I had no relationships there, which isn't quite true. I met Fred there, my husband, Fritz. But nobody, what would I do in Frankfurt without this? They closed up the clinic. We all had to leave. We were kissed off goodbye. And so the hospital, the Jewish hospital, gave me a job. The general Jewish hospital, there was also a Portuguese hospital. Also, not as big, but the general Jewish hospital was quite large. And they gave me a job to finish my training, to help Jewish kids, you know. And I went there for the rest, what we thought would be the rest of my training. And again, all the co-workers, we were such close friends, and again, we did have as much of a good time as we could in our time off and spend it together, because we were good friends.
In all, how long did you stay in Frankfurt?
Almost 2 years. 36 I came in April, and 38 I tried to leave. First I tried. So one of the fun things was, we had a farewell party for me, and I packed and everything. I haven't told that my parents left for Holland in 1937 from Berlin, because my father couldn't do anything anymore. There was no work, no money coming in. And they had well-to-do relatives, cousins in Amsterdam, and they nudged us to come. So my parents wanted to take me with them. I was still not even 18. And I refused. I mean, how can you refuse? But I did. I said I wanted to finish this training. If I go now, what job can I do? I'd be a maid or something. There's nothing I can do. I know how to do. So they relinquished and said, okay, stay. Not gladly, but they left alone for The Hague. And in the meantime, I was there, and we had that farewell party that one night, and they gave me little gifts, teasing ones or otherwise, and I boarded the train, maybe the next day, I don't remember the time lapse, and I had my camera, I had a pretty good camera, I always loved photography, and I had a passport that at one time was made out for me, and it was valid for 5 years. And this was only 2 years had passed since I got it. So I took the passport, the camera, a little suitcase with some things in it, and I thought I'd go home, you know. When we came to the border, Nazis with the regular police boarded the train, checked all the papers, and they did everything. And they come to me and they said, how can a Jew, I mean, they saw Mosaic, that means Jewish, religion, Mosaic, after Moses. I said, how can a Jew have a passport for 5 years, you know? And they tore it up. And they took my camera away and put me in the next train to go back. So here we had our farewell party, here I was back again. It wasn't that funny, believe me, then, but I laugh now, it's kind of funny.
You did return then to Frankfurt? How long did you remain in Frankfurt?
Not too long. I wrote to my parents, and do I do something to the microphone? I touched it. I wrote to my parents. At that time, all mail was censored. Every letter opened, so delayed, the mail was always late. I wrote to my parents and told everything that happened with the professor, with my trip, attempted trip, and that didn't succeed. So my mother took the letter in Holland, in The Hague, to a lady she had often read news about her in the paper. She was like the Dutch Eleanor Roosevelt. And she did all kinds of humanitarian things. She was head of the Red Cross as a president, not as a professional, just president. And she did all kinds of things for refugees or did try to do something for people in Germany and so on. And my mother read all that, and she took the letters, there were about 2-3, where I wrote very honestly what was going on. I thought, if they read it, they read it. I didn't care. It wasn't good news. I wrote all the how they forged the news and all that, and as I say, I didn't care. And nothing really happened. They can't read every letter, I thought, you know, of the millions of mail pieces. So I took a chance, and I was lucky. Nothing got censored, and I picked up. And my mother took those letters to this lady, Mrs. Bone van der Starp, and showed, she got somehow an appointment, like people get sometimes an appointment with the president here. And she wasn't the president of the country, but she was a big lady, prominent lady, and showed her the letters. And she read it with great astonishment and upset. And she said, we're going to do something about it. Just don't worry, I can. And her husband was had a private law practice as well, was member of the Dutch parliament. They have two-chamber parliament, and like here, Congress and Senate. And her husband had his private law practice, and he had a colleague in there whom this lady finagled to do something about me. She showed him the letters, and she said, find out what you can do to smuggle her out or somehow, how, I don't care how, get her out. And he, there was always something on the news with Germany, what they did and what other countries tried to prevent or help. This was still before the Polish invasion, you know, before Poland was invaded and the Blitz on Warsaw and all that. And so he had read somewhere just at that time that three countries, Great Britain, France, and Holland, the governments agreed, to take each 150 children and save them from Germany. They're not their parents, just the children. So that transport from Germany to Holland was just about to take place. So he kind of arranged. There was an age limit for the children, from about 3 years to 16. I was 17, so I was not fitting to be a kid, to be in the group. I wasn't fit to be a leader or a nurse or accompanying them. So they made of me a nurse's aide or something, you know. And so I went on that children's transport, not here, not there, but in the middle. And this lady had, of course, well-to-do and prominent friends, the couple had, and she had one friend who owned, of which she knew that this lady had a property, a big mansion with big land around it, and a pond with swans and ducks and everything. And she asked, do you really need this summer home? I have this problem to place 150 kids. And the lady said, of course you will have that home. It does more good for the 150 kids. There was also a house for personnel who had to maintain the property, everything. And I ended up, and they hired more medical help, nurses and nurses' aides to watch over and daily basis with all these 150 kids of different ages. Some needed schooling, some not.
Were you there very long?
Also about a year.
And what was there a name for this place you were in?
Yes, I cannot say it in English. Hurst in favor. It means a house at the pond, Walden Pond, you know, house at the pond. Anyway,
Were you reunited with your parents during this time when you
No, I couldn't leave that place. And also, the head nurse of this setup was given a baby to take care of. May I tell that story? I don't know how to tell it short. You make me short. Shorten my story. My friends call it draining the pond for a reason which I don't want to say now. And there were illegal shipments to Palestine, then English mandate. And shipments, I mean rickety ships where the captain took a lot of money of refugees from who were fleeing Germany and brought them to try to bring them to Israel, then to Palestine. And the parents of a baby and also two older boys wanted to make the trip, but the captain wouldn't leave them take the baby. It was too risky for all the other passengers. A baby cries, a baby has needs, and when they have to swim to shore, which was often the case, because the British had guards at the shore everywhere, that those things wouldn't happen. So it had to be at night, and secretly, a baby would be in the way, it would risk all the lives on the ship. So the mother and father finally agreed to let the harbor police take the baby and bring it to a relative whom they knew the name and address of. The policeman, for some reason, after a week or two, for humanitarian reasons, was kind of touched by that story. And he wanted to see how the baby was doing, so he went back to the place he had handed over to the aunt and uncle this baby. And he rang and rang, there was no answer. But a neighbor lady opened the window and she said, "What do you want?" And he said, "I would like to see this baby that I bought a few weeks ago." And she said, "Oh, I have the key, I can show you." And she opened with the key the home, and the policeman saw how neglected the baby was, all dirty diapers and skinny and in bad shape. And he just picked the baby up like that and left the house with it. And that's when he handed it to this Mrs. Bone, who headed the refugee program. And that's how she came in there. And I always loved babies. I wanted to become a pediatrician all along. And I always played with her, fed her, she let me do it. That gave her a free hand in my free time. So then the big invasion came, and I showed you the picture, the robot and the mechanized German army and the handful of soldiers that the Dutch had, who were neutral in the First World War and hoped to be neutral now, but couldn't. And so the Germans occupied, the Dutch surrendered after 5 days, after being shot in the back, so to speak, also by their own Nazi party. They had to give up, and the Nazis took over. Puppet government, puppet managers of every business or Jewish business anyway, and they came in. Now the personnel was almost all non-Jewish at this refugee home, except for one young woman and myself. And they had heard such gruesome stories from different kids, from 150 kids, 1,000 stories maybe from 100. And they got pretty scared. What would the Germans do if they come around and know this? And we all, the bigger kids and the bigger children, I and this other lady, we said, "We wouldn't mind if you leave. We couldn't hold it against you. It's a natural thing. You put yourself at risk." So all of them left. All of them. It left that girl and me alone. But luckily not for days, well, in a way luckily, not for days or weeks. Anyway, here we were without help, without anybody. And the next day already, a group of Nazis came with Navy uniforms, some put the brown SR uniform, and with an interpreter from the Dutch police, whom they forced at gunpoint if they had to interpret. Anyway, they came and the policeman gave us a piece of paper, blah, 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 that we had to leave within 24 hours, and what we had to leave behind and what we could take, which was very little, but didn't say where to go. They just said, leave.
Does this include the children also?
Yes, of course, everybody. They needed the space for headquarters for the Navy. It was a beautiful big house. Anyway, so we didn't know what to do, so we called the Dutch Jewish Committee, who kind of sponsored and oversaw that we had food and this and that, took over from this lady who actually only programmed those things. But the final actual help came from the Jewish people. And they're like the JCC, I would compare to. And we called the committee chairman and said what happened. And she, of course, she was in arms and called emergency meeting and so on. And she called us back. She said, "You, of course, you have to leave. There's nothing we can do about it. But we found you another place, a farm home, a farmhouse."
How many children did you have with you?
150, and the baby. And so the minute the Germans came in, they confiscated any motor vehicles, except doctors were allowed to keep their transportation, and the sanitation department was allowed because they didn't want to cause an epidemic, which would involve them as well. So this lady somehow, I don't know whether she or somebody of the JCC did it, commandeered the sanitation department to have the empty trucks transport the kids to the new farmhouse. It wasn't a new house, but for us, a new address. And we ended there with the kids like sardines, mattress next to mattress. Was an empty farmhouse. It was a roof against the elements over their heads and some place to sleep. Mattresses next to each other, which reminds me about something else I forgot. The Kristallnacht, when Fritz left Germany, his waiting number, the quota number, was called up. His was early number. We all had numbers, there were 42,000 or something, and America left very few people in at that time. They had a closed quota. And so he was lucky, he was one of the last people in 38, just before I tried to go to Holland. He had valid papers and prepared for immigration to USA.
Had you been able to see your parents during this period of time? You still had the same.
Not then.
Since they
not
left
yet.
Germany.
But I want to say, when Fritz, the day Fritz left on the train, his mom went with him. The train went first to Berlin, where a brother of Fritz lived with his family. So the mom said, "I want to see Ludi too. He wants to say goodbye." And then went to Hamburg on the ship. And just in time, they were following him everywhere, the Nazis, bureaucrats of them, all that. And he made it on a ship which is American territory before they caught up with him. And so his mom went with him to Berlin, and his dad and I and a good friend of his who had brought him to the station went home again to Fritz's home. I was bringing the old man there to see if he makes it all right.
Do I understand correctly that you had returned to Germany then, from Holland?
No, I jumped back. I'm back in Germany because the mattresses reminded me on something.
But
I jumped back. I'm back in Germany in thoughts, not...
Did this are you telling me now that this happened before you left Germany?
Yes.
Please,
yes.
Let's stay with after we left Germany.
And I wanted to tell this, so you have to hear what happened at Kristallnacht. So when I brought his dad home to make sure he makes it to his apartment, we are in the streetcar, and we see smoke everywhere. We didn't know where it came from. We sat in the streetcar on the lines, you know, tracks. Later we heard that that was the day they burned all the synagogues after Kristallnacht. And when I came back to the hospital, now I'm back in the hospital, but mattresses reminded me of all the hallways of a fairly big hospital were lined with mattresses. And wounded people that were beaten up in the street because of Kristallnacht were laying side by side, again like sardines there. We couldn't go in the X-ray department where I continued my training. This is before I left Germany. And because people were on the X-ray tables, wherever there was a flat place, a person was stretched out, wounded. So we didn't take X-rays. We helped the nurses. We bandaged people or changed bandages, cooled their head with cold washcloths, blah, blah, blah. But these were all the Jews that were beaten up in Frankfurt in the streets and ended up in the hospital. Mattress by mattress. I had to tell you that. So I'm back in Holland again with the mattresses. The kids were sleeping there. We had all the equipment we were allowed, permitted to take out. We had around us in the garden, in the big yard, the big pasture. Of course, the garbage men helped us to put it off, unload the trucks. The kids were sleeping. We sat out in a chair each and watched the planes go down, be shot down. You know, the British sent them over and some were shot down. It was almost a show, you know, if you want to take it that way. Fireballs coming down and all that. So, next day, again, a group of Nazis, uniformed Nazis, comes. They need it for the army or something, for headquarters, this place. So we were at the end of our wits with 150 children cooking. What? How do you feed them and all that? They had brought in a truckload of sandwiches or something that volunteers had made. But you can continue that way. And so this chairman had again an emergency meeting. She said, two, they can't go on like this. And they gave us a list, and they kept the list of all the members of the Jewish community in Groningen and in The Hague. And we had to call. It was like slave trade. Would you take a child in, a boy or girl, what age, blah, blah, blah. And we had them finally all placed with private families. The Dutch Jews were untouched at that time. And I always prayed in my heart that nobody wanted the baby, and they didn't, because nobody wanted to take responsibility for a baby or wash diapers and all that what goes along with a baby, cook baby food, blah, blah, blah. So nobody took her. I took her home with me. That's when I met my parents for the first time. And I haven't even said about Westerbork, but that was in between somewhere. I don't remember that. Oh, yeah, she gave me this job, I think, after Westerbork, but that was a collection camp for refugees. It had guards with dogs, but it was run by the Red Cross. It was a quarantine camp originally, and they converted it in a refugee camp, and that wasn't children, it was families. And I was there a year, and I volunteered to help in the kitchen and did. And we had kind of fun. Saturday night we made a variety show. Everybody who had a little bit of talent or thought so would perform, you know, and we made jokes about each other and rhyme or not. And people who played an instrument and had it with them would play something. So you made always the best of a situation. There was no way, no other way. You couldn't have lived with all this pressure and contest and tense and competition.
You're with Mrs. Ilse Kuttner. Mrs. Kuttner, you were telling us that you'd taken the baby and you were with your parents.
Yes.
Can you tell me about that now?
Well, that was while we still placed the children with the garbage trucks to different families. And I took the baby home that she wouldn't be in this tumult too long. And I brought her home to my parents with her crib and her blankets and all the equipment that was given to her for use. And my mother had just a friend visiting her, and the kid was, of course, with all that confusion. How would a baby know what's going on and why? So she looked pretty worried, and every time she saw me going by and putting something here or there, she would break out in this big, bright smile. Her whole face lit up. And my mother and her friend saw that whenever I was ready to go back to the children who had to be placed to the wherever they were, the farmhouse, my mother said, "Oh, go once more by. We want to see her smile again." So I did it a few times. But then I had to leave, help clean everything out and of children. And that was really good time for us. My parents, through terrible financial problems, which happens in many families to this day, when anybody has financial problems, they go for each other's throat. Not that my parents tried to kill each other, but there were problems and fights all the time. And when the baby arrived, it was like an angel of peace. Everybody focused on her and wanted to make her smile or please her or carry her or sing to her. So she took all the pressure off the family.
Let me ask you, Ilse, of these 150 children, was there any way of establishing who their parents were as they were passed along?
Oh, maybe the older ones could tell their names and addresses, but after the war, everything, who knows where they ended up? I had no contact with any of them anymore. And that other lady I met later in America, and she had not heard from any of them either. This is America. I'm jumping back again to the baby. And my father was so pleased when he has said the mauzer and sang the Kiddush, and we sang and he prayed the Birkat HaMazon. Now he had another baby. When I was little, I sat on his lap and tried to read along, you know, with my finger when I didn't know Hebrew when I was little. And when I was bigger, I read with him. I wasn't on his lap. I read along in the siddur. And
what was your father doing in Holland at this time?
Also tried paper, and he couldn't make headway at all. He didn't know the language, and they took advantage of him. It was a very miserable period I'd like to forget. Finally, they were helped by a Jewish committee, again, a Dutch Jewish committee, in a small village, in a small town. But that's another story I want to say. How, she didn't read with her finger. She beat the music, you know, she conducted with a little finger, the baby finger. She conducted with the music when we sang the things together that you do at Birkat HaMazon.
Was it at this time that you went into the ghetto?
Yes.
In Amsterdam?
Very soon, yes. First of all, no, my parents and I were moved to Groningen, a little town, because one day, I come from the street with a big sheet of paper, and it said, all German Jews have to leave within 24 hours the Hague. But my mother didn't read all German Jews. She just read that we have to leave within 24 hours. And she blamed it on my letters. She said, you wrote, and they probably found the letters that you wrote what was going on in Germany, what got us into trouble. That it wasn't so. We saw them, more people going with the papers through the streets, not knowing what to do. It didn't say again where we could go. It said only leave. And so the Dutch committee, the JCC, again took care of our placement. They knew Dutch geography, so they could say, go here, go there, whatever. And they limited that not one town or village would be flooded, you know. So it was all organized. They didn't touch the Dutch Jews, only the German Jews at that time. They were afraid when the British would invade that the German Jews, having been taken their nationality, their bread, their income, everything, that they would of course help the British. So they want to clear the whole coast of German Jews. We ended up in a small town called Groningen, Groningen. And so...
Were you placed with a family?
With my family, yeah. And so we got a little apartment, very nice and clean, new buildings, new development, and all was very well. But I wanted to work. My parents couldn't take care of me. There was no income, just welfare, Jewish welfare from the Dutch committee. So I cannot remember anymore. I got this job in Amsterdam, working in the Portuguese hospital. They have a big Portuguese community in Amsterdam. They come originally from Spain, you know, the Maranos, and they ended up there. They spoke Sephardit, not Ashkenazit, if you know the difference. Ashkenazit, all the German and Eastern European Jews spoke Ivrit, Hebrew, with that accent.
Were you doing X-ray work in this hospital?
Yes.
That's what you were doing.
It was a small hospital, about 150 beds. And again, we had wonderful contact. Our boss was actually a surgeon, but he took care, kind of read the x-rays and gave the results, the reports, to the different doctors or people.
Were you going home at night, or were you living?
I was living in the hospital. There were little rooms of the place. And then... And I couldn't go home. That was Amsterdam, this hospital. My parents were still in Groningen, in the new development of apartment houses through the JCC. I was in Amsterdam. Then suddenly, as I said, slowly everything got worse. Segregation all. In Germany it got worse. You couldn't sit on a bench in a park. You couldn't go to a theater or anything public, or take a streetcar. Everything was verboten, verboten, verboten for Jews.
What happened to the baby during this period?
She was still with my parents. But when we got this letter that we had to leave The Hague, the chairman of that JCC in The Hague came to us and said that we wouldn't know where we end up if we have to sleep on the open sky or whatever would happen. We would have to give the baby up for her own good, because she had to have shelter. She said that she will have to try first the relatives again who neglected her so, but she would keep personally an eye on it. If there was any wrongdoing, anything not being kosher, and I don't mean with food, she'd take care of it. That she had relatives, I forget where, in Amsterdam or somewhere, who ran an orphanage, but like their own family. They had a limited amount of kids to take care of, and they lived with them. They did everything. Their own kids were part of that enlarged family of an orphanage. And she said, an orphanage, the Nazis would never touch. She'd be safe there. I doubted that, but I had no say. I had no control over it. And I thought it was reasonable to expect that we might have difficulty to get shelter and all that. That it was safer for the baby to be elsewhere.
Was that the last that you saw of the baby?
Yes.
Then?
But
did conditions then change for you while you were in the hospital?
Only that way that finally the Nazis herded all Jews in that area to Amsterdam. And people who were not Jewish had to leave. And they barricaded it, that Jews wouldn't go out to shop or anything, but within that ghetto. And Christians could not come into the ghetto. That's what they thought. And so by that time, I have skipped that also. In Germany already, now in the occupied Holland, everybody had to wear the star, the Jewish star. You had to sew it on your clothes, on your outer clothes, and on your dress or suit, whatever you wore. Yeah, at all times, 24 hours, that had to be tightly sewn on. If you walked on the street, any kid on the street, at the street corner, so could take a pencil and try to take it off if you had really tightly sewn it on, if you went up to any secrecy or something. And so that we all in that was a star ghetto full of stars, you know. And we had to buy them. You had to stay in line for hours. Again, the Jews had to sell them in the JCC to their own Jewish. They had no choice. I mean, there was law, you know.
During this time, were you still able to work in the hospital?
Yes.
You could leave the ghetto to go to the hospital?
Yes. No, it was in the hospital.
It was in
Amsterdam, in the ghetto. Yeah, both hospitals were. There was only one smaller 150-bed Portuguese hospital. There was a bigger one. But
how was
I
your food situation at this time? Were you getting enough food to
was
eat?
Still all right. There were no ration coupons at that point. But then, not all the Jews could come to Amsterdam, so they had different centers, you know, in different regions of Holland where they herded them. So anyway, this is September 42. In the meantime, the baby is still in the orphanage. You know, they took her away from the end. It was again not, they both worked and there wasn't enough attention paid. So I took it again away to this private orphanage. And this one, Yom Kippur, 1942, we went to the synagogue. I have to interrupt you again. I hop, skip, and jump, but I can't help it. One thing leads to another. I was very good friends when I worked in the hospital. I finally couldn't live there. I had to rent a room in a rooming house. And one of my neighbor who rented a room also in the same house was a blind young man with a seeing eye dog and a beautiful young wife. And we became friends. So when we were at synagogue and suddenly in the early afternoon, the rabbi interrupted the services and everything and said he had a report that there would be a raid today. They didn't take all the Jews at once. There were raids, and they take at nights when nobody could watch it or see it. They take truckloads full of Jews to Westerbork. There was now a collection camp to transport people from Westerbork to Auschwitz, Theresienstadt, Birkenau, Dachau, anywhere. But they were collected. And Frank also was in Westerbork. Anyway, the rabbi had heard that tonight would be a raid through the grapevine. So he finished services right then and there. He said, you all go home, pack your rucksack, your knapsack, which we had always have to be prepared on the spur of a moment that we, in the case that we had to leave on the spur of a moment, you had a rucksack, a knapsack ready with the most necessary things that you would take, that you could carry. So he said, pack, check your knapsacks, don't fast, don't continue fast, eat something that you'll be ready if you are it. So we went home, the blind man with the seeing eye dog, his wife and myself, and we decided to go on fasting. We were religious Jews at that time. We would take a chance and go on, and then we would meet to break the fast together at their house, probably, at their room. And so we did. We just brushed our teeth, and there's that noise of the marching boots outside, and it stopped at our door. We look at each other. We had already brought the food that we were going to share, and about the table was set. The Nazis come up again with the police as interpreter, Dutch police, and they had a list, and it had the names of the husband and wife on it, not my name. And he read it to the Nazis and to us, and they were going to take this young couple. So I said, why don't you at least let them eat? We fasted up to now. They go on an empty stomach. That's no way to leave. And then the guy interpreted. They said, okay. They were once halfway decent, you know. Let them eat. And they did. And I took them. I saw them going down the steps, inside steps. And there they were. Friends, my close friends, the dog and everything. Anyway, on the steps, the cop went behind everybody and he turned around and he said, if you know what's good for you, you try to get away, because the next time your name may be on it, or they have no list, they take everybody in the house. So what should I do? What would I do? Anyway, I let it go in one ear, out the other, and there was a chance I heard about. Nobody could use a train, not a public transportation. Amsterdam and Groningen were an hour or so train ride apart. So I didn't see my parents for some time, quite some. So I heard that nurses could go on trains on a day vacation or something if they were in uniform. What did I do? I bought a uniform from a nurse my size, and I bought a ticket and went to Groningen to see my parents. And they were very surprised and happy. This was a while later. And while I was there, my friend, my close friend, she used to be my teacher. I took for 2 years a course in child rearing and education, you know. And she was my teacher, and she befriended me with another teacher, two of them. And they often stuck a theater or concert ticket in my pocket and that I could see it. I had no money. And to buy a ticket. So she comes and visits me in Groningen at my parents' house. And she said, when we were alone, she said, Ilse, Dukes, a common friend of ours who was an author of books, a wife of a physician, she said, Dukes has told me to get you out of here, get you in the underground. She has a person who will shelter you. I should have to ask my parents, give me time. So she left, and I asked my parents, gosh. Okay. I asked my parents and told them of a proposal of yours, and they said, no way. You go where we all go. What can they do to us? They'll ask us to work hard. From hard work, nobody ever died. That was the general idea of most naive Jews before news came from the camps. This was still the beginning, kind of. And we had another friend, these apartment developments had a common courtyard that went all the length of the building blocks. You know, they were all new buildings. Each one had a living room and a bathroom downstairs, some bedrooms upstairs, kitchen downstairs, bedrooms and bathroom upstairs. And there was one pasted to the other, by one long building. And they all had in common a long courtyard, and on the other street, parallel to this street, their backyard met our backyards. There were other people. And I befriended, because I always loved babies, a young couple where he was a doctor, a physician, and a young wife, and they had a baby. So I often went down when I was in the yard, I coochie-cooed with the baby and played and so on. And one day, they were packed up to leave, into hiding underground. And the two young people and the baby. And as soon they went, of course you tried always to go to another city than where you really lived, that people wouldn't recognize you at any point. So they and the baby went to the railroad station to go to another city. And every railroad station, doesn't matter where, the littlest tiny station, there were oodles and oodles of SS, not in uniform, in plain clothes. And they looked around. If anything roused their suspicion for some reason, they grabbed the people and interrogated them, and if there was anything wrong, they either shot this couple and the baby, they shot at the station. Sometimes they take them for interrogation to the SS. Anyway, she said, you remember what happened to Dr. Cohen and the family? We don't want you to go underground. You go where everybody goes, blah, 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 what I said before. So I told yours on the phone or something. I said, I can't go. My parents have this idea, and I better not. And I go back. My time was up. I go back to Amsterdam to the hospital. So in the meantime, things got worse, more raids, more. Every night, the truckloads of Jews went to Westerbork and all that. And it got pretty thinned out, you know, the ghetto. And I thought they left medical people and so to the last, anybody who worked in hospitals, doctors or nurses or aides or what. So I wrote, Jos, who was very daring, this young teacher. One day she had written me that she wants to come the next weekend, not this one, but the next one, wanted to visit with me. And I was afraid. Non-Jews weren't allowed in the ghetto. And I wrote to her a postcard. I thought that they would leave alone. Nobody writes anything secretive in a postcard where everybody can read it at a flick. And I wrote her, I said, you better not come next weekend. I don't have any cookies to offer you. There aren't enough cookies. And she knew I couldn't bake. That was a message. And so she didn't come the next weekend, but the next day. She came, somehow she found a way around the barricades, and not having a star, I don't remember if she had stolen or bought one or whatever, I don't think she had one. She came, she said, you go into the underground, this is your chance. And I said, I don't want to endanger anybody, I don't want them to risk their life for me. And she said, if they don't take you, they take somebody else in. And whatever I had an objection, she overruled it with some reasoning. And while she talked like that, she said, you can't ride with a star in a streetcar, but walk. It was very far from the ghetto, the terminal of the railroad station, of the railroad. And she said, walk, and when you come to the barricades, find the loophole. And in the meantime, while she talks, she tore all my stars off, I mean the scissors, cut the threads off, and only on my coat she sewed another one on one of them, those stars. She sewed on my coat. But with the thread, she made one stitch at a time, with the threads hanging inside, way down, long threads. It was a coat, you know, covered my whole body. So she had it back sewed on with stitches that were loose. She says, when you come there, go in an alley, find an alley somewhere, take the star off and walk across a barricade, somehow bent under, go over. Whatever. And she says, I'll meet you at the station. Do like we haven't seen each other. We just meet there. And I did all that, and I tell you, it was one of the worst moments in my life to take off the star, like betraying my people. And I got to the station. And I saw, and oh, she also gave me her ID card. It wasn't me, but she had a similar slender face and dark hair. And she gave me her own ID card. So I said, if they catch me somehow, just say I stole it from you while you were seeing me, wherever. Don't need to give a location that she was in the ghetto. And she agreed. She said, I will say that. So at the station we meet in big hooray, like we hadn't seen each other in years. And while she shook my hand, she had two tickets in there. One to go on the train and a handshake. And one for my luggage. My luggage was a little weekend suitcase like yours here, a pair of pajamas, maybe a change of clothes, I don't think it would have fit in there, and a toothbrush. That was all. And she also had given me at home a copy of a book that Dukes, who sent yours, had written to carry the copy under my arm. She said at the station in Groningen, where you are going to, you will hold that copy under your arm and you can read it in the train. I knew it, of course, I had always copies of her books. She was a good friend. And you will see a man, young man standing there, and he'll hold the identical copy, not the identical, not my copy, his copy of the book. And that's how you know with whom to go. You make a big fuss about each other like your long-lost friends. And he'll take you to a safe place. So I took the ticket, got my luggage, my little suitcase, and went to the waiting train. There was a terminal in Amsterdam. So it seemed endless the time. The train didn't leave, didn't leave. And while I was waiting, the train, the door opens in the compartment, and there's a Nazi and a railroad, Dutch railroad person. And they look around and they put their eyes on me. My heart started pounding. I thought they might see it, you know, boom, boom, boom. And they come in. And I thought, here you go, yours, your card. And they said, did you just go to the, come from the luggage department? I said, yes, because no use saying no, they probably saw me. I said, yes. So I could hardly talk. I was all choked up. And I said, did you take by accident the wrong coat? I was so relieved, I can't tell you. I said, no, this is my coat.
Mrs. Kuttner, you were telling us that you had just had these Germans come into your compartment, they were searching, and that you found it was for a coat that they thought you had picked up by mistake. Can you pick up from that point?
Yes. I arrived in Groningen finally after reading and reading. I didn't know what I was reading. I was still so nervous from that shock experience. And so I arrived in Groningen, and the young man was there with a copy of the same book. And we embraced each other, and I said, how's your wife, how are your children? I didn't even know if we were married or had children. And so he said, come with me, and I did. We went to his home, and he did have a very lovely wife and two children. 2 and 4 years old at that time. And we really became like family for a few days or week, whatever. I have no time conception. By the way, I would like you to call me Ilse, I'm not Mrs. Kuttner. And we became like a family on Sunday when he didn't work. At early in the morning, it was family kutz time. That means family carriage. Kutz is like in German Kutsche, you know, a horse and buggy, family buggy time. So for a while they still had the Dutch biscuit, the Dutch biscuit. It comes in cylindric tall packages. You can get it here now. And that was really a treat, with a little butter or honey on, and honey on it. And we all four sit in their double bed, and he would often read poetry or some interesting article, and the kids would just stay there for the treat, and then were going out to play. They were interested at that stage in poetry and us. And we're really a family, really. We sat in one bed.
Were you with these same people all the time while you
were hiding? No. I was at 21 different addresses, some repeatedly, I mean, after a lapse of time again. And two families I was a longer time. But
while you were in hiding at this first place, were you able to find out where your parents were or what had happened?
Yes, I'm glad you asked that, because that's why I just suddenly got stuck. I didn't know anymore how that happened. One day, the couple said that they found a hiding place who wanted, would be willing to take a couple. How about your parents, who lived also in Groningen? And I said, that would be great. Why don't you go? And at night, one night, was her name. In fact, our Naomi, middle name is Rina. which means melody or song in Hebrew. And we named her that we could call her Naomi Ree after this Ree, who was so gay. And she said at night she would go and ask, tell them about the possibility. And again, my parents said no, that they'd rather go with where everybody goes and you only have hard labor that doesn't kill anybody. If they would go underground, it's too risky. They're glad to know that I made it, but no, not for them. And we talked about it at their home, at the couple's home, Yap and Ree. And one day, Ree said, I try it again. I go over there and maybe I can get them now convinced. And she went over there, and a short time she was back. She said, Ilse, sit down. I was at your parents' apartment. It's sealed. They're gone. I couldn't believe it. I thought, I kept walking the room up and down, up, back and forth. I couldn't believe it. And I thought they went on some errand for the underground, either moving somebody or doing some sabotage or supervising it or doing it, which I did often. And I thought, I go. I left everything that would, my forged ID card, everything I left behind. I cleaned up whatever could point to me. I put in a special shelter that was always built in every home who were willing to take people into hiding. There was always a hiding shelter, so I put anything that could point to me in the hiding shelter, and I left.
Elsa, was your brother with your parents during this period?
Yes. I went to, I knew where we had lived. I had visited there and so. And not now, earlier. And I knew that the steps went from the outside, that went to the entrance of the apartment. There were downstairs apartments that were fully equipped with everything. But the second floor apartments had on that second floor kitchen and living room, and the bedrooms were on the third floor. And I knew my brother had his bedroom on the third floor. There were decks connecting all apartments again, like the courtyards. The entire blocks were one deck. People had their garden chairs out there, sun themselves, whatever. And I knew my brother never locked his room. So I thought, I go to the neighbors who were very friendly and trustworthy. I felt, I didn't know for 100%, but I took the chance. So I thought I'd go up. I couldn't break the seal. I thought, and it was locked too. And I thought, ask the next-door neighbor. There were two entrances from when you went to the outside steps up inside to the building. I mean, it was somehow built that way, like on stilts you went there. Then there were two doors, my parents and the next-door neighbors. And then the rest was on one floor, and the next floor, the bedrooms. So I rang their apartment, and they were surprised to see me. I said, could I try your deck and see if my brother's room is open? And I said, sure. And I went. And I went, and the door was open. I went inside down to the first floor of the kitchen and the living room, the dining part of the living room, dining room. I can hardly tell you what I saw. There were dishes with food stinking. It was kind of summer, I guess, or early fall, hot. Stinking dishes with food on the table. silverware and all that. And the kitchen, still the pots on the stove with the food not finished, stinking. I had only one thought. I have to do something. I took some big sacks, bed covering that had a slit where you slid comforters in, you know. I took those as sacks, and I took everything that was silver, our candlesticks, silverware was silver from their parents or whatever. I took linen galore and blankets. I could hardly carry it. I stuffed it all in that big sack, bed sack. And I pulled it over like Santa Claus. I pulled it over. I tell you, I thought, I never smile again. I never can talk again. I felt dumb, deaf, and everything. I took that thing, the sack full of things, and went to the neighbors and let them have the first pick of anything, silverware or linen, anything, towels. And they did pick a few things. Because they left me go, they took a risk, they let me use their apartment. So then I went home undisturbed. I mean, I wasn't checked or anything on the corner where usually people check your ID card or so. And with that stuff all in the sack, I came undisturbed to their house and went in. I looked first if anybody was in the neighborhood. At dark, nobody could have, there was blackout. You couldn't have any curtains open that would show light. I went back to Japanese, and they used the linen and so, and Jos came at times to visit. I couldn't live in her home. She had only a room in a big rooming house. But I was too public, I couldn't hide there. But I let her have, already before I went into hiding, I gave her all my books I had. And I gave her linen and so on, whatever, the silver. And I got it back after the war.
When you went to see this neighbor that lived next door to your parents, did they give you any idea of what had happened?
They were taken by the Nazis, and I know where, to Westerbork, the collection camp, and from there to anywhere. I didn't know at the time which camp. It was Auschwitz, I found out from the International Red Cross after the war. And that they had no mentioning in any list of the names anymore except when they arrived. So the Red Cross assumed from their experiences that my parents were gassed at arrival. And my brother and his wife also never was heard from again.
Now, getting back to your life during this time when you were moving among the various hiding places, did you have any idea what was going on in the war, how the progress of the war was?
Yes, we had, in closets, the Germans, as soon as they came, they confiscated not only all automobiles, vehicles, but also all radios, electric or battery driven or anything. And of course the underground had the risk already, hiding people, so what's the difference of another risk? So they kept each a radio, battery powered, and we listened to the Voice of America and BBC and CBC, the Canadian broadcast, and we knew what was going on. It was terrible interference. You had really try to understand what the news was. But you always could make it out somehow. Something was coming through. And you had to hide under blankets. You couldn't put it loud enough for anybody to hear. It was a great risk. And then often the people where you were hiding would let you tell them the news, if you were listening, or whoever was listening, and they printed down with a typewriter or something and made copies and would run around and distribute it to underground people. Not everybody was underground. Some were regular people. And if they were Nazis, they were never caught. I mean, not that I know of.
Did you personally do anything in the underground?
Yes. I was at one place that was abandoned. I mean, was going to be abandoned. The people wanted to withdraw from the underground because of a sad experience they had. The couple they had hidden had also a baby which was taken away and hidden elsewhere, where people could say they adopted it or something. The baby didn't look Jewish, apparently. And the parents were so miserable, of course, natural. They couldn't ever shake it, you know. They got so depressed and it was so hard to have them around you that the people, the hosts, got depressed. And they told the head leaders of that one group, the underground wasn't one big group in all of Holland. It was little cells and groups, different denominations of churches would offer to help people hide. Political parties, anti-Nazi, would do it, and private people would hide their friends or find places for them to hide. And they weren't all Jews. There were people who were opposed to Hitler and the fascists, and they had eventually to hide because they were in danger of being found out.
What was your job when you were working with this underground?
This one man, Jaap and Rie, the leaders of that particular group, had asked me if I would save that place for him. They knew I could get along pretty much with many people, different sorts, laborers, blue color, white color, wherever I was, doctors. I hadn't had any trouble, and I thought maybe I could save that place by being there and making friends of the people, that they wouldn't think everybody's so depressed and hard to get along with. And I did go. And this guy's regular job was topographer. He made maps, and he had a very fine hand in drawing things like cities on maps that were ghost towns or ceased anyway to exist, or new towns that sprang up. So that was his kind of his job. So he took over the forging of ID cards for hiding people. You couldn't use your old, even if you weren't Jewish, with a big J in the ID card, they still couldn't use. The numbers were registered everywhere. Nobody who hid could use their old ID card. So the ID cards that were to be used had to be gotten from somewhere. So many people had just that job. They would go to a restaurant to eat. When they go in the courtroom, there was often no person that watched your codes. They would feel in all the pockets, and most people have it in their outer coat pocket, and they'd steal all, as many as they could, as they found. And kids in school, we had teenagers who would do nothing else. But when they went so-called to the bathroom, asked the teacher permission, they end up in the hallway and steal those cards. And many of them ended up with this man who forged them, but of course the secret storage place, so that you could end up with a card. There were so many that would fit your age, your sex, and come as close. I had one, because of my German accent, it was hard to place me. I mean, to get an ID card for me. But they had one that was from a girl who was born in Germany to Dutch parents who returned to Holland at all the when all the difficulties started. She wasn't Jewish, so it was a safe card and was close to my age, and that would explain my accent. So I helped this man. It was quite difficult to forge it. It wasn't just that he had to change one digit of every number. That would change the whole number if you change one digit. It was hard to, you know, you had to take the number that was easiest, that was palest, and all that. But also the Germans had first on the ID just pasted the photo of the person belonged to on the top of, on the page of the ID. But as many people just removed the old picture and put their own on, they had to find ways of making it more difficult, and they did. They cut part of the page out, only strips where you slipped the corners of the picture under. But the middle was hollow, was no paper. So they pasted on the back side of the page the a tissue paper. It was so full of microscopic printing, like your dollar bill. If you try to study your dollar bill, they try to make it also difficult. A thousand tiny little words or designs that make it difficult to forge that. So we had to use that same tissue paper, but we had somehow to remove that tissue paper from the all old picture. It had to be removed. It was a tedious, slow job, and I got saddled with it because I had so much time. And I did with a little brush and with like nail polish remover, acetone. I had to take that and real slowly and carefully without tearing it, get the tissue removed that they could put the new picture in and put, you know, get the old one out and get the tissue back on.
As the war started to wind down and end, who were you liberated by?
By the Allies. We were, and I was at that time, the other place where I was fairly few weeks or months, it was a one-room school teacher who had volunteered in a little tiny village to hide someone. And that time, the big places like Amsterdam, The Hague, etc., in Holland, the Nazis tried to starve the people out. They took everything of the farmers all the time. They harvest at harvest time. They had a hard time and did hide some food, that they kept some for themselves, and they shared a lot with the underground, which was marvelous. We had no ration coupons, even after they were, at that time, they were needed. We didn't have any because we had no legal way of getting them. So sometimes the underground would do sabotage, break into a city hall and get all the ration coupons. And sometimes the Nazis were fast enough to declare them not valid. But sometimes we got away with some of that. They.
How were things once you were liberated?
It was pretty good. I was one of the so-called evacuees to be the teacher. One of our cousins or nieces from the big city came because there was no food. In fact, the Allies, mainly Americans, had food drops to the city. It was dangerous because there were the Luftwaffe airplanes to try to keep them out. But so they sent the kids away to the country. I was one of her nieces who was sent to the country, but she didn't let me get too much around. for my own protection because my accent, you know, the neighbors might wonder and doubt.
Now, as this time, as the country was liberated, how were you able to start to maintain contact with your future husband?
It hadn't been easy. It was really a miracle that we did get into contact. But I want to tell one funny thing, jumping again to the baby that I brought home, because the neighbors all thought they never saw a daughter. The daughter was talked about by my parents, but there never was a daughter. When she finally comes home with a baby, and they wondered if I had that baby somewhere, that I was pregnant illegally. I mean, unwed mother. That was funny. Anyway, I come back to how I got in contact with my husband. I had no contact with him whatsoever for 8 years because even when the Allies went in the war at first, till later in the war, they sent troops to England. But I was really wondering how I get in contact after the war, because he didn't know I survived. How could he know? So I happened to remember the address of one of his cousins, where he lived with in New York. And I just tried, it was paper scarceness of everything in Europe. So the postcards were that small, and it's in our kids have our photo albums and scrapbooks, so they have the little postcard that I wrote to this cousin, who didn't live anymore. She did live in New York, but at a different address, not anymore in Audubon Avenue, Manhattan, but in Fort Washington Avenue, which I didn't know, of course. I wrote to the old address. So the mailman couldn't deliver this postcard. He laid it on the radiator in the hallway where the mailboxes were, in these big, huge, high-rise apartment houses in Manhattan. He thought, which he was right about, that one of the neighbors might know where she moved and take the card and give it to her. So he laid it on the radiator. Nobody took it. Everybody seems to read it, but nobody took it, knew where she was. One day, an old neighbor who had lived there came to visit another neighbor who still did live there. And she found the card and read it, and she thought, I know where Bertha lives. I'll take it to her. And she pushed it in her, put it in her pocketbook and thought, she'll give it to her. But she forgot it. Several months. One day she looked for something in her purse and found the card. And she thought, oh, forgot all about it. I have to call Bertha or go there. And she went there and gave Bertha, the cousin of my husband, now he was my husband then, but Fred's cousin, gave her the card when she visited her. So the cousin happened to know that Fritz was in town on leave at that time. He was still in the Navy, where he had enlisted to go to serve. And he was in the ship's band of the ship called Europa, and brought fresh troops to London and had leave there. And they took wounded troops home, and people who had finished tour on duty took them home. And he entertained the troops with the ship's band. He played the trumpet there. So he was on leave here in America, in New York. She called him up. He was visiting his new girlfriend or fiancée. And when he went to the phone, she said, "It's a call for you." This Bertha said, "Guess who wrote?" And he said, "Right away, Ilse." And she said, "Yes." So he was in shock, you know. He thought I had died. So he went back to his girlfriend, and she said, "What happened? You're white as a sheet." He said, I heard from somebody I thought was dead." So she said, "Ilse?" He had told her, and she probably asked, "Are you engaged? Are you married?" When they struck up a friendship. And he said, "Yes."
Now we're going to wrap it. How did you then come to this country, Ilse?
Well, Fred, after his honorable discharge, had got a job offer in Johnstown, Pennsylvania, became a cantor there. He had the education. He went to yeshiva in Frankfurt as a child, as an early student in high school. And, of course, was brought up Orthodox and had all the knowledge and wherewithal and knew all the music. He had in the Hauptsynagogue and the chief synagogue of Frankfurt, he had the music knowledge and the wherewithal to lead a choir and told the cantor which service they would sing. There were three cantors in that chief synagogue. They would take turns, and he would tell them which number of service they would sing, and the choir would sing, and he was in charge. Anyway, when he got this cantorial job through a cantor, one of the Frankfurt cantors was a New Yorker cantor. He had this job offer and he wasn't taking it. He liked New York. So Fred took it and was accepted. And with the help of the rabbi, he got through the joint distribution committee to get a ticket for me on the Ile-de-France. That was
Ilse Kuttner. Ilse, you were telling me then that you came to Johnstown, Pennsylvania. You were married there.
Yes.
And did you begin first
of December, then? 1st of December, 1946, we got married. After 5 days' stay in New York, we got to Johnstown, got married by the rabbi in his office.
How long were you in Johnstown?
15 years. We lived. A very nice incident happened. We were very close friends with a Lutheran minister couple when the synagogue was downtown, a little place. There was a remodeled private house a woman had given that to the temple. And across was a huge Lutheran church. And we didn't get acquainted there, but we lived very close in the upper residential area, in, like here, Westmont, like here, West Side, you know, was a residential area on the top of a Allegheny Mountain, one of the little mountains.
Did you begin your family in Johnstown?
Yes. They both were born there.
How many children do you have?
Two. Daniel, Gideon, and Naomi, Rina. And I only want to say, on the day that Israel became a state, Fred asked Walden Hall, could he play their Glockenspiel in the top, in the attic, in the top floor of the church? Could he play the Hatikva? I don't think any Jew or Gentile recognized it. I mean, not because it wasn't the right melody, but nobody was very familiar with Zionism at that time. So he let him play in the Lutheran church the Glockenspiel, the Hatikva.
When did you come to Omaha then?
In 1961, he got a job offer here. There was some difficulty with the other congregation, with the rabbi whom we loved very much. And they tried politicking him out, and Fred couldn't take it, couldn't take that. We loved that rabbi very much. And they did some dirty stuff, and we didn't want to stay. And through the rabbi who was out, dismissed, Fred got this job here. I mean, he told, the rabbi asked, what your cant are doing. He said, this rabbi still said, I don't know. I give you his number, you can ask him. So that's when Fritz had an audition in Pittsburgh in the airport by this rabbi, Brooks, Rabbi Brooks.
Here at Temple Israel?
Yeah.
In Omaha.
He had him come to Omaha, and we moved here. But the kids were born there.
I want to thank you, Ilse, for allowing us to come into your home and listen to your story, which we find very, very interesting.
Thank you so much. I'm glad to contribute to this history of the Jews.
Ilse, can you tell me what this is?
This is one of the many stars we had to sew on our clothes with my friend removed and did with loose stitches. The name, the word Jew is Dutch, Jood.
Can you tell me what this is, Ilse?
This is a forged ID that was adapted to my picture and my number, the forged number. And if I can open it, this is the inside, and we've panned now to the forged, the loosened tissue paper that was so finely microscopically printed, and then it had to be loosened from the back of the picture. It is attached to my picture now.
Ilse, can you tell me what this little pouch is?
Yes. It is one of the two pouches. The other got lost, and meanwhile, with moving and all, where I had hidden notes that a very close friend, whom I called Mom in Dutch, Mem in Friesian, had written notes from prison and smuggled them out. And Rie, the wife of the couple who took the leadership of the underground in that cell in Groningen, she had made that little sack for me that I could attached to my bra. It can be removed with a little, what you call these little buttons. I could remove it to try to hide it or throw it away or flush it down the toilet. I wore these notes. I kept, they were from prison smuggled, and I hid them inside my bra. How about the pic? This is my husband's honorable discharge from the Navy, where he had enlisted and was in the ship's band.
Ilse, can you tell me what this is?
This is a picture and a writing explanation of a record Fred made while he was a cantor, and he died not too long after this. He sang Jewish songs and secular songs, both on it, and Hebrew songs, of course, Vishomru ritual songs. Vishomru and the Kiddush, it's all on there. Wonderful.
Can you tell me about this picture, Ilse?
That's our son, Daniel Gideon, Kuttner. He's not married, but he has a child, a green grandchild, I call it, a more miniature parrot.
Can you tell me about this photograph?
This is Fred kissing his daughter right after the wedding. And I can hardly talk, I'm so moved. He died 3 weeks later of a heart attack, his third heart attack. He had two in that year in 72. Naomi Rina is called Rina from the Birkat HaMazon. First of all, to honor Ri, who was one of the biggest help to make me survive, and also from the Birkat HaMazon, those who sow in tears shall reap in joy. Ulshaneno Rino should. Bedimo Yiktsoru, those who sow in tears. Berino Yiktsoru, and joy shall, and joyous song shall harvest.
Can you tell me who these boys are?
One, the older one, is Benjamin Garrett, called Ben, and the other one is called Bodhi for a nickname. His name is really Brian Alexander. They're 18 and 15 years old, 15 and a half, and live in Greeley, Colorado, with their parents, Naomi Rina and Russell, called Rusty because his hair is red. They are blonde because their parents are red and black haired.
And they're your grandchildren.
Yes.